Well, I think you've proven the fact that people like to come to the farm to buy their vegetables and see who produced it and see the land that it grew on and all of that.
Yes, we're trying to sort that out. I think it's a social component to that. And it's a dog component to that. They like to take their dog. And that's why we have the chickens over there. So as to encourage people to come around, take a walk, see the crops growing, and buy a few token vegetables.
Well, I really enjoyed coming here. What got me to come here was, you know, I saw that you were selling tomatoes for 50 cents a pound, and I go, I'm there. So I came down here, and they were the best tomatoes.
Oh, you found them?
They were the best tomatoes I ever ate.
Yeah, I wouldn't credit me for that. I think credit that to the weather.
Mm-hmm.
There's a whole group, if you enter reading books about tomato culture, there's a whole tomato culture. And those folks are no water tomatoes. And they have tomatoes which don't get any water once the fruit is set. And they put plastic over them, so they can't get any water. And so they grow and they get exquisitely flavored.
Wow.
Because they're not getting in as water.
That's
diluting.
Brilliant. That is brilliant. Yeah.
That's what the winemakers have been doing forever. Yeah,
exactly. Right. Exactly.
It's controlling the amount of water to keep the flavor as powerful as you can. So I think that's what's happened this year with the
tomatoes. Many different kinds of tomatoes do you grow?
I don't know, probably a dozen. I'm not a nut about growing. I'm trying to grow tomatoes that will grow here and will sell, rather than trying to grow an unusual green stripe tomato. I think that's more of a toy than a food.
Mm-hmm. Those yellow tomatoes that you had are fantastic, though.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
We have a sink full of them at home.
And make sauce out of them when
she's
I go
a great
home.
Sauce maker, and our favorite way to eat them is just to take the tomatoes, put them in a frying pan with some garlic for about 30 seconds.
No, a little longer than that.
And it goes right on the pasta.
Right.
You don't cook it down forever. Yeah. Little basil.
We have garlic. A little basil right over there. I tried planting some in mid-August. It's not very happy though. They're 10 acres. This is just one of them.
Oh, really? Where's the rest of the farm?
It's L-shaped.
Ah.
It goes all the way over there. And then we'll be having a group going over to University Drive near the Wings restaurant where we have an acre of corn. And I want them to pick it all and shuck it. But they'll pick it, throw it in there, and we'll bring it back here. They'll sit out here under the trees and strip it. Then
nice.
We'll put that in the greenhouse to dry, and we use it for chicken feed.
How big is this farm right here, this area?
That's about 1 acre that you're looking at right there.
And you have 10 acres, goodness. That's
so that they said, this is called the upper field, that's called the willow field, the next one the swimming pool field, the next one the chestnut field. We have an acre of chestnuts over.
Now, Connie told me that you used to live here, and that after you sold your house, you kept the land.
My father lived in New York, and when it was time, when he wanted to sell his business in New York, a business which made Ralph Nader famous, by the way, he was a private eye. He moved up here, and it just happened that this land came on the market by the widow of the previous owner, Mabel Armstrong, Captain Armstrong, and We bought this whole thing, and I built the house for them here. And then it was since sold to Paulina Stark, who's an opera singer, who of course would need a place in the middle of nowhere to vocalize.
Don't break any glasses.
We got the opportunity to buy a leftover piece that the church didn't want, 3-acre piece over there. So that then our land on University Drive is not ours. That's a friend of mine, Mohammed. And he sold it this few months ago to some developers that just got permission to put, in effect, student housing on that land on University Drive.
Well, the university just keeps growing, doesn't
so
it?
So we will not be farming there, I don't think, next year.
No, you've had the farm since 1976, is that so?
In that ballpark, that's when we planted the willow trees.
That's as little beautiful, whips. Beautiful trees. I was over here the other day and the wind was blowing and they were just really putting on a show.
Yeah. There's a pond beneath them, which we created to take care of the roof drainage and the driveway drainage from the house, but it's gone dry with the drought.
How did the drought affect you this year?
A little, because we have, right at the corner of the greenhouse, we have a 26-foot deep well that's made by an excavator tool mm-hmm. from Carl's Excavating. And then they backfill that with 3-foot diameter concrete pipe in 5-foot or so sections, one on top of the other, and then backfilled with washed stone. And then we also had a water problem up there. The water creeps out of the slope from uptown, so we put what they call a French drain, curtain drain up there, and directed all that water into the well area.
That's brilliant.
So we have a well which has 25 times 50 gallons in it. It's a 50 gallons per foot. And we use drip tapes. You see it sticking out right there, the little mm-hmm. pressure breaker, which reduces the pressure to 12 psi. And those drip tapes have emitters every foot, and they're underneath the plastic, and they emit and keep it watered. So we would look and see what rows needed some water, and we'd water them.
How long have you been using the drip tape?
Drippy tape and our underground pipe system, which we have at every field. We have these hydrants, it's called.
How long have you been using the drip tape?
20 years.
Huh.
And we always, when a bad season like this, we always forget once or twice and leave it on all night, in which case the well went dry. Because we planted, this time of year, we planted a month ago, spinach for the spring. It winters over. So those seeds had to be kept watered. They were. We left them on overnight. The well went dry. We turned it off, and as expected, the well recovered at least 8 feet in depth in the next 2 days. Came back, turned it back on again.
What is your best crop in terms of paying the bills?
Paying bills?
Most profitable. Corn,
probably,
tomatoes,
flowers? No, corn is not profitable.
It's too much of a commodity. Huh?
Well, it's just, you have a whole armful, as much as you can carry. That's maybe $8. It's just very, very cheap on a per pound basis. It takes a lot of space. Good thing is it doesn't take a lot of work to grow it.
You have a lot of flowers.
Yeah, probably flowers are the highest, we have the highest use. People come and cut their own flowers and pay $30 a bucket or
wow.
$7
yeah.
a bunch.
And you sell those at the farmer's market as well.
Yeah, and we sell a lot of a lot of bouquets. Connie makes bouquets and sells them to Whole Foods, a lot of them, and Atkins.
And this is where you do all of your prep here. This is a nice little area.
That's where the people making bouquets sit, and the people cleaning the vegetables sit on this side.
Yeah, you've really got it down to a science here. You've really got a pretty tight operation going on. Connie, you make some of the most beautiful bouquets.
Really?
Tell me just a little bit about how you put these together. How do you design a bouquet? What is in the back of your mind?
In the back of my mind is my product, what I have available, and what I know is in the field, and what is ready to be picked and looking good. And then color is my big thing, putting certain colors together. So.
And shapes, too,
and shape
look pretty
and
important.
Form and mixing, textures, and keeping a balance of height and color. Just a few things.
Now, how many different types of flowers do you grow? Do you think? I mean, you don't have to give me an exact number.
Well, there are many different types, and then there are many varieties within the same type. For example, this is celosia. This is celosia.
All right, well,
this is celosia. And they look very different, but they're all varieties.
Okay.
And I would say between 50 and 100 different seed packets.
What are your favorites?
Oh, the Lysianthus are wonderful. They look so good, and they last so long that people sometimes ask me if they're fake.
Connie, do you have a tin opener?
Yep. Excuse me, I have to give change.
Oh, you have to do some business, too. I was telling you that running a used bookstore seems to be a lot like running a farm, and it's the same thing. It's the same thing. When somebody buys something, I say, oh, I guess I can interrupt my reading or something else to sell you something.
To make a sale.
Yeah, to make a sale.
This is Phyllis Lair.
Hi, Phyllis.
Connie Gillen.
I'm John, Northampton Community Television. And I came over to the farm a couple weeks ago and was buying some tomatoes. And I said, it's running.
Oh, okay.
And I said, I got to come back and film the farm, get some of it on film. Now, do you work at the farm as well?
We are Sunset Farm, and this is Connie and Bill Gillen.
And helpers.
I'm a helper.
How long have you been working there?
Over 2 decades.
Wow.
And I get paid in all the green beans I want, and I don't particularly like green beans, but that's okay. It's good to have the exercise and be out in the fresh air. We have flower bouquets. We have arrangements. At this time of year, we've got potatoes, tomatoes, onions, leeks, scallions, okra. We're the only ones who have okra. And it's winding down, though, because now we're starting the full crops. We've got pumpkins. We've got acorn squash, butternut squash, buttercup squash, and spaghetti squash.
And we will have chestnuts.
Yes!
We're the only people, probably in the Northeast, that have a stand of 25 trees that are at least 25 years old that are producing edible chestnuts.
We lost two in
because
that storm
the blight
3 years
had,
ago.
Taken them out.
They're a blend. Tell them what they are.
It's a Chinese American hybrid.
Yeah. And they are resistant to the blight.
Yes, yes. And people love them because if you want chestnut stuffing, you got to have chestnuts. And they're great in pumpkin soup or pumpkin bisque.
So you'll have them this fall.
We will have them in a week or so.
Yeah. Oh, great.
But again, every other year is different. One year we had like thousands of pounds, and then one year it was, you know, like this year we had great zucchini. It was absolutely fabulous. We were giving it away, and nobody took it. But anyway, we did sell some, and, but you know, one year.
And fabulous tomatoes.
And one year,
we have been loving
the eggplant was just modest, to say the least.
The eggplant's good.
Yeah, this year it's fabulous. Yep, we got great eggplant.
Now, you have a great location here just as you walk into the farm. Is that because you've been here the longest?
Yes. We used to be over there, but
you've worked your way up.
We worked our way.
Well, I'll let you get back to doing your business.
Well, thank you.
We've got
and
some great footage
down
of your
We're
farm.
We're here every Saturday between 8 o'clock and 1:30.
Yep.
And it goes until mid-November. So, what's that special? Come on down.
Come on down. You've got a great spokeswoman here. Thanks, ladies.
And we get.
What's your name?
I'm Bob Sear. I'm actually Bill's neighbor.
Uh huh. And you help him out on the farm?
Yeah. I'm also a volunteer, but I do a lot of the repair work on the tractors and all in my garage, and I do any of the field work as far as like plowing, harrowing, mowing, things like that.
Now we're coming to the end of September. What's what crops are you pulling out of the ground at this time of year?
Well, harvesting.
Yeah.
Well, we still have squash. This will probably be the last weekend for tomatoes, watermelon. We still have pumpkins. It's going to be, we're nearing the end on the flower. The parsnips will be all year, you know, because they can be dug out in the middle of the winter if people want them. We've just planted spinach, so we'll have a late fall spinach come in, because through the season we still plant a lot of things right up until the end of the year. There's certain things that'll go through the winter snow. And
amazing. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
You have some beautiful rainbow chard going on down there.
Oh, yes.
That's just fantastic looking
and
stuff.
It's actually, it looks really good right now.
Yeah.
You know.
When do the chestnuts come in?
Chestnuts are normally right at the end of September, first week of October. This is going to be a poor year because of the rain, but we will probably have maybe half the crop that we normally have. There are some out there.
How many chestnuts do you get out of 12 trees?
Oh, gosh, tons.
Tons? Huh.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
We'll sell to Whole Foods. That's a big race. When they start coming in, we have to get them, you know, knocked down and picked up faster than the squirrels. You know,
and those are the ones that people put in their fireplace and roast.
Oh, yeah. Those are nice because that's a crop that we'll keep. So it doesn't matter if we sell it right away. So that's a nice type of crop to have around. Other things, you know, you're harvesting and you need to sell it right away. You know, otherwise, for the most part, a lot of things will just go bad anyways. That's why down here, a lot of people will come down here and they'll pick their own. And that's fine because they're getting the freshest stuff they can get, and we're not putting it in a cooler or on the table waiting for someone else to buy. A lot of people that come down here are just regulars. They come down here all the time, every year, and that's actually helpful. It's less work we have to do, and they know right where it's coming from.
Now, how long do you keep this farm stand open? When does it close?
The farm stand, this cooler here will stay open all year. Whatever happens to be in there, we'll have wreaths, because as the flowers near the end, a lot of the women will do the dried flowers. So Connie will do wreaths for the winter, and there'll always be various types of squash, because we'll have tons of squash that we'll keep. You know, they'll be put into just a nice dry place, and so there'll be a few things in there almost all year. But we try to have vegetables every weekend, even for the market, because the market goes well into November.
Well, this is just a great farm. I mean, it's not a gentleman's farm, it's a professional farm, and it's right here in the middle of Amherst. More people can come and visit, maybe even people from Northampton.
Oh, yeah, it's a community farm. The people that live around here, they are so happy to have this here because it's a little piece.
It's like their own backyard garden, yeah.
It really is. It works out nice. I mean, a lot of them probably get a kick of seeing the tractors going down the street, you know.
I love coming here. I'm from Northampton. I've been driving over here every weekend. I come over here anyway, but this is now a regular stop for me.
Yeah, yeah. It's very peaceful. I mean, even at night, I come down here every night just to sit and read or sit and watch, just to, you know, let things blend away.
Great. Well, thanks a lot, Bob. I really appreciate your time.
Yeah.